communion tonight. We'll be having communion, and you'll come down the center aisles. And there's battery lit candles down here. Battery candles. Pick up a candle as you come for communion. And you'll have to kind of squeeze through. We're already set up for our second service. Squeeze through or come down the first pew, and then exit back around in through the outside aisles. Communion. A lot of misunderstanding about communion. Communion is God's gift to the world. Okay, so that's the bottom line. It's God's gift to every individual. God doesn't pick and choose and say, you can have and you can't. We're told God so loved the world that God gave God's only Son so that all might be saved. And so these sacraments that are behind me on our communion table are God's gift to you. And so if you would like to receive communion, you do not need to be a member of this church. You do not need to belong to the United Methodist Church. It is for you, God's gift to you. So I invite and encourage you to come and to receive this gift from God. Oh, I know one other thing I wanted to mention. We have an individual in this church, Virginia, that does a lot of our artist work here. And we've asked her to put murals on the windows in the back of what we've talked about in the 4 weeks of Advent, starting on my right, your left, and it goes right through. Interesting enough that this morning we talked about needing to have a concreteness of our faith, and she put the Advent candle on a cinder block, which I love the symbolism. But you'll notice each of the windows reflect a little bit of what we've heard all week on this journey for what we know will be an incredible, incredible day tomorrow. Would you quiet your hearts as we prepare to participate in this service of celebrating the birth of Christ?
Thank you, ladies. Church, can you stand with us this evening for our gathering? Our text tonight from Isaiah, the 9th chapter, and Luke, the 2nd chapter. And as always, this is responsive. Good news, unspeakable joy.
A great light has burst forth, overcoming the darkness.
A child is born for us. A son has been given.
Bring a kingdom of endless peace. We shall call him Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God.
Come, let us see what God has brought us.
Let us see what the Lord has done.
Glory to God in the highest.
And on earth, peace and goodwill to all.
Let us pray. Holy One, you have appeared in the flesh, bringing redemption to all. Your glory is made known in this newborn child, this living, blessed hope. Tonight, we sing a new song, a song of justice, righteousness, and endless peace. Gift of God, beautiful Christ child, we welcome you. Let love be born anew in our hearts on this joyous night. Amen. You may be seated.
My friends, Advent is a time of waiting. Last year, these two were prepared to play for us at Christmas Eve. We have waited all year. We had to cancel our services because of weather, and so I'm excited for you to enjoy what some of us have already heard.
Given us your greatest gift, your very word come to earth to live with us and through us. You have filled us with your grace and truth, your holy child sent to free us from our bonds.
How can we repay such divine generosity? Receive our thanks and praise.
As you have given to us, so now we share your gifts and your grace with the world in need.
May this offering help bring your light and love to those who still wander in darkness. Amen.
Amen.
Tonight we conclude our journey of Advent. I suppose some of us here are expecting a typical type of sermon leading up to Christmas. You know the kind of sermon I'm talking about. The kind of sermon where someone stands up and kind of sneers at materialism and condemns the consumerism that's found in Christmas. Or the kind that joins the voices of popular Christianity, calling us to fight back. We just talked about peace this morning. But the sermon that says, fight back and put Christ back in Christmas, are the ones to where you're simply invited to pull up the recliner in your pew and relax in the glow of candlelight. And maybe write one or two more Christmas cards if you've not been kind this year. You may have heard those kind of sermons. I'm not planning on giving one of those kind of sermons tonight. In fact, I can't give you that kind of sermon tonight, because I happen to be a proponent of materialism at Christmas. Good, nobody got up and walked out. Did you hear me right? I think and believe that at the very center of Christmas, that it's about materialism. Let me give some simple facts. This year in the United States, we'll spend over $1.6 billion on live Christmas trees that will die a week after we put them up. We will spend almost $1 trillion on gifts for our pets. Yeah. Santa will receive 2.2 million letters. And now we've added a Black Thursday, a Cyber Monday, a Black Friday, shopping, but that's not the materialism I'm talking about. I'm talking about another kind of materialism. Because you see, at the center of Christmas is what we call the incarnation. That's the heart of the season. Do you know what incarnation means? It comes from the Latin, and it means to be made flesh. That's what incarnation means. To be made flesh. In fact, if you take the Spanish, which is a cousin of Latin, they say incarnacion, which when you translate it, it says God in the meat. So I think that's what Christmas is all about, right? The incarnation. God being in our world. It's eternity coming down to humanity. It is God in the form of flesh. It's the blessing of the material things that we have so that the material things that we have are a blessing to others. I personally think Christmas and materialism should be spoken together more often because I know that I need materialism this year. There may be some of you or you know of those that also may long for a material Christmas. I lost my father in February. And many people have told me how sorry they are that I'm going to have to go through this holiday season while grieving the loss of my father. And I have to tell you that I crave the reality of this season. That God actually put on flesh. I love the fact that God actually came down to us here on earth, meeting us where we are, sometimes in our sadness, sometimes in our grieving, sometimes in our mourning. I crave that light of the world that finds me when I'm in my dark place. I need that voice that I can audibly hear that cries out in the wilderness to prepare a way for the Lord. That's what Christmas is about. Love coming here. That's why I need materialism in Christmas. I don't think we as Christians do it very well, though. I read some of the writings of Donna Schaefer, pastor of Judson Memorial Baptist Church in New York City. She actually wrote an article. Let me just quote just a little snippet. She says, the spiritual and the material have come together in the Christ child. A human, one like us. And then she gets very descriptive. One with a pancreas. God has come and is with us, has knees and hips. Even has an unwed mother. End quote. And there it is. She actually named what I was craving for, what I believe the world is craving for. She tells us why I need to divorce our Christian theology, why I don't need to divorce it from materialism. Because in reality, God became a material human being. God came into a complex world, a world that was messy. The spiritual finds itself born of an unwed mother lying in a manger next to a smelly donkey. I read about a Methodist church, United Methodist Church, who every year puts up a nativity scene on their property. It's always controversial. But I think they got this, right. In a stable scene, instead of like the ones that we would normally find on Christmas cards, they invite their community into their nativity, a woman holding her child in a jail cell. They're putting flesh on Christmas. In the darkness of someone's life, Christ comes in. Why? Because that first Christmas was a smelly Christmas. It was the Christmas that was that the two individuals were threatened by poverty, filled with the suffering of real people on real hillsides, in the real streets of Bethlehem, where the message to them was, there's no room. Noisy, far from sweet and quiet, lullaby-ish. You see, I believe there's a narrative change that's taking place in our world as vast numbers of people are describing they long for the spiritual side of God to be made manifest in the material side of their lives. They want God to be a part of what's going on in their lives, not just a Sunday morning only event. Maybe you describe yourself that way. I think it has something we can learn from. Something that can really describe what Christmas is supposed to be, both spiritual and material. I mean, Christmas has always been religious. Love came down at Christmas. Love came down to a stained and smelly earth and in less than perfect circumstances. There's no bleached white robes. Comes to us as a baby on a chilly night, with the smell of a cow in a barn. And yet when we look at that story through God's eyes, there's no split between the spiritual and the religious. There's no split between the spiritual and the material. God has always intended to be a part of our lives. That's why I wish you could be with me when I visit in nursing rooms, nursing homes, in hospitals. God is there in the messiness. God comes into the room when your boss is unjustly treating you. God is there giving you support and strength and stands by you when you hear the phone ring and you find out that your son has just been arrested. God is there when you receive that call in the messiness of life and your daughter has just been thrown out of school. That's where God rolls up God's sleeves. And works in your life. Sits beside you in the emergency room when you can't stand the pain anymore. Sits quietly as you quietly struggle with the flavorless world of depression. That's what the Gospel of John really tells us in such beautiful poetry. We may have missed it. We go to the Luke account where there's words and words about angels and this and that and everything else. We go to Matthew, the wise men traveling from afar. But I think John, the Apostle John, got it. I like his story of the coming of Christ the most. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and guess what? The Word became flesh. There's the incarnation. The Word came to where we find ourselves in life. So So I'm here to say this evening, is there room in your world? I hope you haven't missed the message tonight. It's not about the stuff, but it's about God being real in our lives. I hope that that you heard the word tonight, that Jesus is the one who can be with you because he has been here in flesh. Or as the Spanish would say, he's been here in the meat of your life. And in Jesus we hear these words that we need to hear the most. That is that Jesus is present. That Jesus heals, brings hope, can provide you everlasting peace, and more than anything else, can help you hear God's love song, the love of God. That came down at Christmas, love all lovely and love divine. Love was born at Christmas, star and angel, they're the ones who gave the sign that God is actually in our midst. So I ask you this evening to join me in Christmas, the real Christmas. Embrace the material Christ in your life. Embrace Jesus as God's song made flesh so that we might experience the love of God. But more than anything else, open your hearts, as messy as they might be, and listen for the sweet, quiet voice of peace that comes from knowing Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
assistant come forward at this time. And as you come, we remind you that to pick up a candle and wait until we come to our candle lighting portion of the service. My friends, this is the best that we've got. Jesus actually said at that supper, this is my flesh. This is it. This is our sign of God is really with us. So everything's been said. All that's left is for you to come and to receive this incredible gift from God. Come.
Thank you.
Well, my friends, it just dawned on me, we haven't really told a Christmas story, have we? And it's centered around our candles. That's what it's all about. So I'm going to invite some people to come and just briefly walk through that story. And at the end of that story, after the candles are lit, they're going to come down and they're going to stop at each of your pews for you to turn on your candle. And if we can turn lights down when we get to that point, that would be awesome. And so are those that are helping, would you? And there'll be some songs in between there as well for you to sing.
And it came to pass in those days into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, under the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, she being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered, and she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn.
Which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Thank you.
the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, "Let us go now even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which the Lord hath made known unto us." And they came with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger.
Life of selfless service began. The Savior dedicated his life to blessing other people, as expressed by his chief apostle Peter. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good. Never did the Savior give in expectation of receiving. He gave freely and lovingly, and his gifts were of inestimable value. He gave eyes to the blind, ears to the deaf, and legs to the lame, cleanliness to the unclean, wholeness to the infirm, and breath to the lifeless. His gifts were an opportunity to the downtrodden, freedom to the oppressed, forgiveness to the repentant, hope to the despairing, and light in the darkness. He gave us his love, his service, and his life. And most important, he gave us and all mortals resurrection, salvation, and eternal life.
Self is a holy gift. Christmas is a time for giving. Someone once said that He couldn't think of what to give for Christmas. The next day in the mail, he received an anonymous list which read, "Give to your enemies forgiveness. To your opponent, tolerance. To your friend, your heart. To all, give charity. For the hands that help are holier than the lips that pray. To every child, give a good example. And to yourself, respect. This Christmas, mend a quarrel. Seek out a forgotten friend. Dismiss suspicion and replace it with trust. Keep a promise. Forgo a grudge. Forgive an enemy. Be kind. Laugh a little more. Express your gratitude. Welcome a stranger. Gladden the heart of a child. Take pleasure in the beauty and wonder of the earth. Speak your love, and then speak it again. God be thanked for the gift of his Son, the Redeemer of the world, and Savior of mankind, the Prince of Peace, the Holy One. Join with us now in joy to the world."
Hold on a second. Catherine, come over here a second, please. Yeah, we'll put our candles down in case we burn each other. Listen, we have joy. We have joy unspeakable, joy to the world, and that song and what we've been trying to do is to help you parents. There are cookies in the back in case you forgot them for your kids to place for Santa. And there's hot chocolate as well, so it might be cold by the time Santa gets there. But please, at least take a couple of cookies and then stop by the back at the end of the song. Okay.